here we are. The day has come, and I have read my first Colleen Hoover book. And as a deaf person, naturally, that meant that my first Colleen Hoover book is going to be maybe someday. For this channel, I'm going to talk about the book as a whole, but if you want specifically and more in-depth probably conversation about the deaf representation in this book, because that's why I read it, obviously, you can go check out my main channel. But I've got a lot to say about this book. So maybe someday is an older book of Colleen's. I'm not sure how popular it is compared to some of her more recent work and more controversial work, like It Ends With Us and her new stuff like Verity, which I'm also currently reading actually. But Maybe Someday is about a girl named Sydney who has been living with her roommate and she has a boyfriend. Her boyfriend comes over often, and as it turns out, her boyfriend's been cheating on her with her best friend slash roommate. Boyfriend and roommate had been getting on for a while. They used to have a casual sex relationship before boyfriend and Sydney were together. So there's that, and they seem to continue that anyways. But before she finds out about it, there's somebody else that knows about it, and that guy is Rich, who is her neighbor who she sees from across her balcony because he comes outside playing his little guitar. And Sydney is into music. In fact, if I recall, she's in school for that. And so every day she's been going out into the balcony. I think in this book it's about a 2-week thing. And you know, she's falling in love with the music and all of that. And Ridge has seen this happen. He has seen the cheating happen when Sydney goes back inside to do whatever, and then they kind of come out onto the balcony and start making out or whatever. Of course he doesn't tell her this. I think he only told her like right on her birthday, which is a terrible birthday present to have. She ends up being homeless now because she no longer wants to live in that apartment. And Rich, who feels bad, has offered to let her stay in his apartment because this girl has been sitting outside in the pouring rain. And he feels bad because he didn't tell her 2 weeks ago when he knew that it was happening. So Sydney ends up being the fourth person to live in that apartment. It's Ridge's apartment first and foremost, and then there's two roommates. One who is Ridge's like best friend, I believe. And then there's Bridget, who is a roommate but is also like the friends with benefits buddy of Warren, and eventually I think they end up in a relationship. And in this time, Sydney finds out that Ridge is deaf, and thus it becomes this whole thing of deafness, and they fall in love. But here's the problem. Ridge has a girlfriend named Maddie who is actually also deaf, but Maggie also has CF. I believe the full name for that is cystic fibrosis, but if I'm wrong, I'll have it up here. So Ridge and Maggie have been together for like 5 years. He is massively in love with her. He feels loyal to her because of her sickness and all this other stuff. And of course, here comes the love triangle and emotional cheating and... oh. It's such a heavy thing in this book that it just gets on my nerves. Here's the thing. It all can't be sunshine and rainbows and flowers and puppies in a book, in romance books even. In real life, that's just not how that goes. So I'm not opposed to this cheating being there, even the romanticizing of the cheating. I mean, it is what it is. This shit happens in real life. That doesn't mean I can't be annoyed when reading it, because my god, is it annoying, the back and forth. First, I want to talk about the deaf representation part. I was very, very worried about somebody like Colleen Hoover writing a deaf character, because the way I have not read this book yet. It Ends With Us. It's in my bookshelf right there. I've got it from the library. Her writing relationships and them being abusive with domestic violence and stuff, but trying to play it off as if it's not really that. I got very worried about how she was going to write a deaf character. Of course, those are two very different things, but still. I hate to admit it a little bit, but she actually didn't do so bad. I did not hate it. I thought I was going to hate it as much as I hated the writing in Hush. Now, I don't know what kind of research she did prior to writing this. I don't know if she knows any deaf people. I don't know if she's consulted any deaf people and did any sensitivity reading, but I was pleasantly surprised. Of course, there were things that annoyed me, but that means that it was true. Like, for example, Bridget. When she first comes across, I'm gonna be looking at my Goodreads notes here because I highlighted a bunch in this book. When Bridget and Sydney are first like together, when Sydney comes into the apartment, Bridget's trying to talk to her and Sydney isn't really responding. I think it's mostly just because Sydney is just completely overwhelmed by everything that's just happened. She literally just yelled at her ex-boyfriend and her roommate, her best friend, and now she's in a different home and all this other stuff. And so she's not really responding, or she's not really given the time to respond. I don't know. And Bridget goes, "Wait, you're not? Oh my God, you're deaf." And then she says, "God, Bridget, you're such an insensitive bitch sometimes." So she says this, she realizes this, but then you want to know what she does after? "I have to go to work now." Very loud, very over-enunciating. It's unfortunate how often that just happens. Now, I have never really had anyone screaming at the top of their lungs at me, but I have had people talk a lot louder and then try to over-enunciate, which really doesn't do anybody any favors because now I'm so distracted by the massive change in mouth movement. Also, it's just so slow. It's like, and when you over-enunciate your words, it actually makes it harder because now it doesn't really look like the word anymore. It's so annoying. When you find out that Ridge is deaf, you're like, how is she doing this when she knows that Ridge is deaf? Bridget, you've been living with a deaf man for I don't know how long, but you should know this. Come to find out, she does the same thing to Ridge too. And still, at this point, Sydney had no idea that Ridge is deaf, but you get some context clues because at one point she says, "So, do you want me to call you after I get home?" And Ridge says, "Just text me." That's a little bit of foreshadowing for us. At one other point, after they officially meet for like the first time once she's in his apartment, she's saying out loud, "I need a drink. Do you have any alcohol?" And he's just like looking at his phone. So he's not responding to her because he can't hear her. And she says, he's staring down at his phone texting again. He either can't do two things at once or he's upset because I had an attitude with him today. Well, in this case, he kind of can't do two things at once. He can't know what you're saying and look down at his phone at the same time. And of course she's getting upset now because he's not, you know, paying attention. He's not responding to her. This is true because oftentimes I'm going to a store or something, right? And people are trying to come up to me. They're behind me. They're out of my vision and they get frustrated with me. Once I was at a grocery store and a man got really, really mad until the person that I was with ran over to him real fast because she saw him getting really upset and was like, "Oh, she's deaf. She can't hear you." And then all of a sudden he was very apologetic and running away. And so she's looking visibly upset and he texts her, "If you aren't going to look at me when you speak, you might want to stick to texting." This annoyed me just a little bit because it's like, dude, just tell her you're freaking deaf, right? Like right off the bat, she doesn't understand what the hell he's saying. So finally he says, "I'm deaf, Sydney." And then she's like, "Oh my God, how is he deaf? You've only texted with each other. Of course you wouldn't really know." And then she ends up hurt that he didn't tell her that, which to me is just like, I mean, okay, for me personally, you know, if I'm meeting friends on apps and whatever, if I'm meeting somebody in person for the first time, like if they're running up to me, I don't know who they are, and they're trying to tell me something and I don't know what they're saying, I'll tell them I'm deaf. But my kicker here is that Sydney is seeming really, really offended that Ridge didn't tell her that he's deaf. She even says, "Not deaf is something he should feel obligated to tell me. I don't know. I feel a little hurt that he didn't share that fact with me." This part's really funny. She texts, "Why didn't you tell me you were deaf?" And Ridge texts back, "Why didn't you tell me you could hear?" That was sassy. That was a little bit of deaf sass and I giggled at it. And then comes the most common question that hearing people tend to ask, and that's, can you read lips? Because there is a misconception that all deaf people can magically read lips. You see it all the time in movies and TV shows. But the reality is only 30 to 40% of the English language can be read on the lips, and that is still under best conditions, you know, really good lighting, no extra background noise if the deaf person has any residual hearing that could, like, you know, clash with that, and also just having the lip reading skill at all, which is something I really don't have unless I really know the person and I've seen them talk for like forever. I can lip read my dad. I can't lip read my neighbor across the hall. And this is where Colleen actually gets it right, because he says, you know, it depends on the lips. I've learned to anticipate what people are going to say more than anything. I take most of my cues from body language and the situations I'm in. So if he's at a store, the cashier, they usually ask typical questions. Going to a restaurant, you tend to know what they're gonna ask, so you can kind of work around it. And Sydney is confused as to how he can lip read her right now, because she's like, well, this isn't routine for you. And he says, well, you're asking me the same questions that hearing people ask, which is true. They ask the same questions. Y'all ask the same questions all the time, which isn't a bad thing. You know, just for the love of God, don't ask us how we know how we're done in the bathroom. Yes, that's a serious question that people ask sometimes. And Ridge is appreciative of the fact that Sydney isn't acting like it's the total end of the world that he's deaf, which is nice, because a lot of the times there are people who will find out that we're deaf. You know, if somebody's coming up to us at the store asking us a question, and then we'll say, I'm deaf, I didn't understand what you're saying. And we'll try to, like, I don't know, do something where we're gonna get our phones out to do a typing conversation, especially since people aren't usually carrying around pen and paper, like, out and about anymore. It's different than, like, if you're going to, like, an office somewhere. Yeah, so sometimes people will look at us like we have the plague. It's a deer in headlights look, and then they'll run off, and you're just like, you feel a little bit offended, because it's not like I can't answer your question. I mean, I might not be able to, depending on what your question is, but there's a possibility I have an answer to your question. But then they just run off, and it's like, I'm not incapable of answering your question. You just need to ask it in a different way. But people don't really tend to give us that chance, because we're working with hearing people all the time and trying to get communication to work, right? But for some reason, not really working here. So really, the communication between Sydney and Ridge is going to be solely via messaging. They'll text to each other rather than using like a communications app or like notes, just writing it off notes and then passing the phone over. I will say this is the type of communication that I had for 2 years with an ex. Didn't really work. Ridge is fluent in ASL. His best friend, also roommate, Warren, is a CODA, aka a child of deaf adult, so Warren is also fluent in ASL. That's just how Ridge communicates. And in the beginning, it makes sense that Sydney and Ridge will be, you know, messaging each other back and forth, whether it's on the phone or eventually if the conversation becomes like this very, very long, like deep conversation, they'll move to their laptops and like message on Facebook. But you notice that as time progresses in this book, I think it's like 6 months, Sydney doesn't really know any ASL. She doesn't attempt to learn it. She just keeps wanting to type to him or speak to him and hoping that he'll lip read her, expecting that from him. And then she'll get frustrated at some points where they're not really communicating and they're clashing, and she gets upset. And I get it, you're frustrated, but you can do something about it. You have the means to do something about it. Because to be quite honest, it's not like you're really doing anything except moping around. So you've got time to pick up an ASL app on your phone or on your computer. At some points, it's like she'll blame Rich for a little bit, but then she realizes that it's not really his fault. Girl, just pick up the damn ASL app. Any ASL app that's, you know, legit, and learn some stuff. You've got the time. You could have asked Warren to help you out even if you really wanted to. I mean, I know they weren't really trying to get into a relationship, even though they were getting involved because they've kissed. But if you're going to be living together for so long at this point, technically, but if you're going to be living with each other, why not put in that effort? We're not expecting fluency, but considering how much you're working together on music and just being together, why not be respectful and learn his language so you can communicate a little bit more easily? And you can still incorporate the messaging, the texting, because that's just how it is sometimes. So talking about Maggie for a little bit, again, Maggie is Ridge's girlfriend of 5 years. She is also deaf. She is actually less deaf than Ridge is. Maggie also wears hearing aids and can speak and sign. Ridge does not wear hearing aids and he primarily signs, obviously. You do find out down the road that there was a time in Ridge's past where he would speak a little bit, but because his father especially would ridicule him for the way that he sounded, which is also a thing that happens in real life all the time, he just didn't want to, you know, speak anymore. Also, it's just the fact that language deprivation. His parents don't want to learn ASL for him. Rich had to go learn it on his own, and then he eventually taught his brother. So yeah, Sydney and Maggie meet for the first time. Sydney's kind of perplexed because, hey, Maggie is understanding me a little bit more. Again, Maggie has hearing aids. Deafness is a spectrum. So you'll find some deaf people wearing hearing aids or cochlear implants. There's a lot of deaf people who don't. There are deaf people who speak. There are deaf people who only sign. There are deaf people who do both. I do both. And I like Maggie. I relate to Maggie because we grew up sort of the same, I guess. I mean, we both have the same communication methods. We both do have hearing aids. My hearing loss is worse than hers, I'll tell you that. God, the mental gymnastics and all the emotional cheating. Because Ridge is starting to fall for Sydney and Sydney is filing for Ridge. It's so funny to me because Sydney was always saying, you know, I don't want to be like Tori, my best friend who, you know, was involved in sleeping with my boyfriend, my ex-boyfriend, you know, that whore and, you know, all of this. And she was like, I'm not going to ever be like one of those. I'm not going to be like her. Only to find out she's going to do the same thing. Not quite to the extent of Tori, because Sydney and Ridge only end up kissing. But still, she's involved with a man who is involved with another woman for a very long time. So girl, what do you do? I like seeing the way that Ridge and Maggie interact with each other. They're signing together. It's nice to see. I will have one thing to say though. I wish that when there's signing involved, it would have been like in italics. Does it really matter? Does anybody care? I don't know. But for me, it just would have been nice, I guess. I don't know. At least that's the way that I format mine when I'm writing my books, when I'm writing my stories. If they're signing, then it's going to be in italics. Then the spoken language will be in regular format. That's just me being a little bit nitpicky though, maybe. Here you go, there's a love triangle. It gets even worse now that Sydney and Maggie know each other and Maggie's coming over. Sydney's very, very jealous. She's jealous that she can't have Ridge. She's jealous of what Ridge and Maggie have. You know, they could communicate with each other, da da da. Again, Sydney, if you maybe pick up a damn app once in a while. But not only that, it's just this back and forth where Ridge is complaining that he knows that he can't cheat on Maggie. Sydney knows that she can't help Ridge cheat on Maggie. Eventually they're going to anyways because they kiss and then they feel guilty. So it's just a sub story back and forth and back and forth. And let me tell you, I could not give a damn about these characters. They bored me. See, at first the writing in the beginning seemed incredibly juvenile to me, and then it started to get a little bit better. It, mostly towards the end, like the big showdown finale. And then I actually started to care a little bit. The writing was, you know, okay, but oh my god, I cannot really care about these characters except for Maggie. And then Bridget was probably the highest on the list because she gave that comedic relief every once in a while, as annoying as it was, because just a lot of it was that screaming at deaf people thinking that was gonna do anything. But hey, you know, eventually Bridget and Maggie break up because Maggie knows that these two have fallen for each other. They kiss. Ridge is eventually trying to get Maggie to take him back. Maggie has this whole like really big thing happening with her CF and she's in the hospital. It's a really bad one this time. And so of course he feels bad. He feels like he has an obligation to stay at her side. What does he do? I cannot even remember. But he's starting to run off, I think, back to the apartment to find Sydney. And as this happens, they both get a text message, and it's from Maggie. With the messages, one of the messages that Sydney and Ridge sent to each other is basically saying, hey, Ridge has cheated on you. I thought that was a very, very wonderful moment. I'm reading the book, and I'm like, oh my god, I cannot believe that just happened. Because that's perfect. Just send the text messages. That was amazing. And then the most annoying thing. So Sydney makes it a huge deal that Ridge doesn't speak. And I hate it. I hate it when hearing people are trying to force deaf people to speak in a way, because it just it comes back to the whole history of oppression and orgasm, and you can go on my main channel for more information about that. This is not the place for that. But that's where that stems from, and it's just, Ridge isn't comfortable speaking and all this other stuff. Ridge wasn't even comfortable telling Maggie a lot of stories about himself as a kid. He's been telling Sydney some of the most deep things that he never told Maggie, and it's mind-boggling to me. He just has never spoken to Sydney, and Sydney's like, oh, I wish he would speak. I want to hear it so bad. And, well, we wish you would sign, Sydney, but you haven't done any attempt at that to even learn the alphabet, have you? Anyways, at one point, he speaks to her. Now, this is like right around the time that Maggie is in the hospital. Sydney, he whispers it, and Sydney is gasping and clutching a hand to her chest. Her heart is just disintegrated. Oh my heart, hearing him speak is almost too much to take in. Each word that meets my ears is enough to bring me to my knees. It's not even the sound of his voice or the quality of his speech. It's the fact that he's choosing this moment to speak for the first time in 15 years. This is giving Deaf Baby Hears for the First Time videos energy. And then what tends to occur, especially after moments like this, or what my worry was going to be, is that then she would start to pressure him to use his voice more. So it makes it easier for her, but it's gonna make it harder for him still, because she's not going to attempt to learn ASL. And so what are we doing with this here? Again, this is what happens in real life. So as much as it annoys me to read this in the book, Colleen wasn't wrong when she wrote it. And there are a couple of times, you know, throughout the rest of the book where he talks and then she's like melting because of it. Girl, please. I mean, I understand, you know, loving men's voices or women's voices, you know, like, I like hearing some men talk sometimes, but it doesn't have to be that. It's just because, oh my God, this deaf man is speaking. He can speak. Oh my God, it's just, it's weird. It's, Sydney has a massive hearing savior complex is the point. Okay, so now again, Ridge is trying to win Maggie back. Eventually, I think it's a couple of weeks of them not speaking with each other because Maggie doesn't want to talk to him, understandably so. Eventually, Ridge goes to talk to Maggie, and he wants her back, you know. He doesn't want to give up on her. As much as he is like loving Sydney, falling in love with Sydney, he has this obligation to Maggie, he feels like. And like this love is the deep love that cannot be broken. Maggie, on the other hand, as much as she loves him or whatever, she's like, this isn't working. This just isn't working because it's pretty obvious that you're just with me because you feel sorry for me because I'm sick and, you know, I'm probably gonna die in 5 years or whatever, and you keep holding me back, really, from just living life because, you know, she's talking about her thesis that points in the book and he doesn't really like hearing about that. So he thinks that Maggie should stay, like, in this little protective bubble. Like, Maggie is this little delicate flower, and so she shouldn't really be out doing things. I mean, maybe she shouldn't be out drinking a whole lot, which is what caused her to go into the hospital and have that really serious moment. But going to school and working on a thesis and stuff like that, like, yeah, I mean, she might die in 2 years, 5 years, but, like, why not do what other people are doing? So, yeah, they're no longer getting back together. And now it's still like this little bit of a back and forth with Ridge and Sydney. It's too soon. So eventually they're gonna get together. Sydney and Ridge at the end of the book are going to get together, and you would think it's gonna be like, yay! Honestly, I can't give a crap enough about any of them, either of them, to care whether or not they get back together. But here's the thing, regardless of the fact that Ridge and Sydney are now together, Sydney is never going to be the first pick, and Ridge tells her this out. Right. Sydney does ask Ridge straight up what would happen if Maggie comes to text you, comes to your house, whatever, and says, I want you back. Are you gonna run off to her because she was the first love of your life? And she has the right to ask that because as annoying as Sydney has been, Ridge is playing the two of them and has been playing the two of them all this time. If she texted you right now and said she made the wrong choice, would you go? Would you walk out my front door without thinking twice? And this man has the audacity to say that's not a fair question. How is that not a fair question? You've been emotionally manipulating and playing the feelings of two different women. and putting him through this back and forth, this heart-wrenching back and forth, that as annoying as Sydney is, doesn't really deserve. Maggie definitely didn't deserve it. So what do you mean that's not a fair question? I think that's a fair question. That absolutely is a fair question. If you two are going to be in a relationship, she's still having to worry about the other woman because you keep thinking about her. So he says, I have always loved her, I do love her, and I will always love her. She's an incredible person who deserves so much more than what life has handed her, and it pisses me off to this day when I think about it. She deserves better than you too. So even after I knew I had found in you what I would never find in my relationship with Maggie, it still wasn't enough. No matter how much I cared for you or how deep my feelings for you ran, it never would have been enough to get me to leave Maggie. You know, I've had someone tell me who I wasn't even official with, tell me something sort of similar, completely different words, but it had the similar sort of tone and meaning behind it. And this would piss me off. It pissed me off when I had to deal with it. This is pissing me off now. So when you ask if I would choose her over you, you're presenting a situation that I can't give you a straight answer to. Because yes, at this point, I probably would walk away from you if she asked me to. The majority of my loyalty still lies with her. But you're asking who I need more, who I want to be with more, who my heart craves more. My heart decided that for me a long time ago, Sydney. And then he starts to speak out loud with this. It's you. My heart wants you. And then she just goes off the rails happily so. And she's crying, grabbing him the shoulders, kissing him or kissing his heart and then kisses him. Silently thanking him for giving her reassurance. How is that giving you any reassurance? Well, I guess he is reassuring you that he will leave you if Maggie wants him to, but that wouldn't work for me. That, no. As much as I'm convinced he would do everything he could to protect my heart, I'm still too scared to hand it over. I don't want to give it to him until I know it's the only heart he's holding. Well, it's never going to be the only heart that, your heart is never going to be the only one that he's holding, and he's told you this. But yet you still end up in a relationship with him. But after this conversation, they don't really talk to each other. It's kind of similar to the beginning of Ridge's and Maggie's relationship, because Warren and Maggie were together before this, but then when they broke up, Ridge was like, I'm gonna wait a year. So this is kind of what they're doing right now. I think it's been like 3 months, and Ridge is tired of it. So Ridge wants to hold a little show and then get Warren to lie to Sydney and get her to come out and, you know, make that, help her with her final decision, because he wants her to be the one that says, yes, I want to be with you, or no, I don't want to be with you. It's her decision. So Sydney gets fooled. She's over there. At this point, Ridge has been working on his speech. It's improved. Hey, go you, dude. Again, let me say this. If Ridge wants to, this is bodily autonomy, right? And it's very important with deaf people. It's very important with us. If Ridge himself wants to work on his speech and he wants to start using oral communication more, then so be it. That's because it's his choice. But my issue is, and this is the opinion that a lot of us have, we don't want to be pressured by abled or hearing people into doing that. We got that enough from 1880 Milan Conference and Alexander Graham Bell. We have enough of that already, even now, with deaf schools being shut down and people trying to sue schools because they're involving ASL with their deaf students. It's the whole thing. I don't want his decisions to be made or influenced by Sydney putting that pressure on him and doing that hearing savior complex thing. That's not the way to go about this at all. But hey, he's speaking during this. Great. It's improved. Great. Hey, if you work hard on something, you should want to see that improvement. And then finally, at this point, Sydney is signing. She's only signing win. And she's signing win, win, win. That is the only sign that she knows at this point. Okay, actually, as it turns out, she knows about 200 signs. Which I guess in 3 months is fine. I mean, I don't count how many signs that I know. I'm not fluent. I grew up in a life that wouldn't let me get that access. So we're working on it now that I'm by myself finally in Omaha where there's a good deaf community. Yeah, so Warren's been teaching her how to sign. I will say one thing that made me laugh and I thought was cute was that she was so worried about signing I love you wrong. Well, I guess if you did, this is the more casual way to do it. So if you're trying to express that you are in love with somebody, you probably wouldn't want to do this for the very first time. You would be doing like, I love you, right? And then afterwards you'll be doing this, whatever. So she was so worried about that she would be signing it wrong. And I'm like, girl, that's like one of the easiest signs because you literally are just pointing. The only actual real sign is this, and that's so simple. It was cute. Rolled my eyes a little bit. Listen, my love life is in shambles, so I'm a little at love right now, but it was cute. And there's that. They get together, they do things, and I come to find out that the situation doesn't really get any better because apparently, now I'm only judging by reviews at this point, but there is a sequel to this. It focuses more on Maggie, which I suppose maybe I would want to read it because if it's going to be from Maggie's point of view, then I'm going to be curious to see more about how Maggie's deafness and stuff is written. So I don't know, maybe that'll happen in the future. But apparently, as far as communication goes, Sydney's not any better at learning ASL or knowing any ASL, and they're still texting back and forth. Does anyone want to confirm that for me in the comments? Because I'm telling you, as somebody who has done 2 years of somebody only writing on the notes app or a texting messaging app and me having to read it, a conversation that could take 2 minutes is going to take 20. And you still don't even get anything out because there's just, it doesn't work. So, and that is the end, essentially. I gave this book 2 stars because it wasn't the worst thing I've ever read. Yes, there's cheating, there's emotional cheating, and then eventually physical cheating once. It doesn't seem, to me, it doesn't seem like it's quite as controversial as what it ends with us is going to be. So, okay, 2 stars for that, and also just the fact that the way that Colleen wrote out Rich and his deafness and Maggie's deafness so far has actually not been terrible. I mean, it's been annoying, but it's just the fact that that's just how it is. So I can't really yell at that. I can't say it's wrong. It's just annoying. But really, I got bored during the book a bit. I did like that it was, it's not really different because it's another music book, but I do like the fact that she is saying, yo, deaf people can be musicians. We do have deaf musicians and singers out there. I do think that it's a cliche that we're involving deafness and music again. Sound of Metal, Coda. It's just, you know, you want a different idea, but this came out, I think, but this book came out before both of those did, so okay. But it also is not new. There are things that have come out before, maybe someday, that have been about that. But yeah, the characters were essentially pretty boring and I just didn't really care a whole lot. There were moments that I did, and again, near the end, I'm like, I'm a little bit invested in them, but it shouldn't be the last 10% that I get a little bit invested. And yes, it would have been sweet with them, you know, really connecting with music. I thought I liked that part, but it's just the whole emotional back and forth and whatever with the love triangle is just... But again, I can't really fault there being a love triangle because again, that's just how it is. I can get annoyed by it. Anybody can get annoyed by it, but I'm not gonna be like, we should never have emotional cheating love triangles or whatever in books because that's just not real life. Let me know what you thought of this book down below. I may or may not have a write-up available on Patreon for this. But if I do, there's a link down below. But hey, if you are wanting more book content, I have a Patreon page, like I said, and at the $5 a month tier is where that starts, but again, anything is wonderful, you get exclusive content regardless, and I would very much appreciate it if you became a member. Of course, be sure to subscribe here if you have not yet, hit that notification bell. Thank you for watching, I appreciate it, and I will see you later.